had a training day for all their staff on the day the campaign launched. Never, not a good idea. The phones didn't stop ringing, and it was just, it was very bizarre, very bizarre. But the most extraordinary thing happened. Within a few days, we had 38 people that had come forward saying, I think it's me, that helped you. Literally, one after the other, these people came forward. It was me, or it was a friend, or it was my cousin. But the most amazing thing is that these people hadn't helped me, but they'd helped someone else around that time on a bridge in London. I don't think we quite realise how many people, unfortunately, go to bridges in London to end their life. But we also don't realise how many, we call them silent heroes, people like Neil. How many silent heroes there are, like Neil, just, you know, going on their way, but stopping to talk to someone off the edge. And then just, yeah, just amazing, amazing stories. But none of them were the person we were looking for, and the charity we were about to give up, we thought, we're not going to find them, and that's okay. And then...
Just a bit of a spoiler to the end, because I'm standing here, right? So, you know, the journey is as interesting for you. So, really quickly, just where I left off on the bridge, Lee's drove away, I went to work, so back 2008, and having that conversation around suicide, the first time in my adult life as a guy as well, and really, you know, listening to somebody open up to me like that. When I got to work, you know, I couldn't concentrate all day, and I didn't mention it to anybody at work because, you know, I was late. And I thought, you know, if I spoke about it, maybe somebody would just dismiss it, or, you know. So I didn't tell anybody at work that day. When I got home that evening, I phoned my girlfriend, I was dating at the time, Sarah, and I told her about this conversation. And then over the next couple of weeks and months, when I saw friends and family, you know, I would say, yeah, I got to work, and I spoke to this guy, and and getting off my chest, I felt quite positive about the interaction, you know, he hadn't taken his life that day, but my daily commute to work for years and years was always Waterloo Terminal, Waterloo Bridge, Covent Garden, and I would always think when I walked past that spot, you know, what happened to that guy, and it was firmly etched in my memory all that time, our conversation. If you fast forward 6 years now, it's 2014, so life, you know, moves on inevitably, and things are really busy for me. I'm now running my own personal training business, boot camps, retreats, and that sort of stuff. Me and Sarah are engaged now, so I'm planning my wedding that year. So I'm just working incredibly hard, you know, early mornings, late nights, and I've not seen the news really. This Find Mike campaign is out all over TV. 300 million people global impressions, and Lorraine Kelly, and I've missed everything. So I can't find myself to sing. It was Sarah, my now fiance, who reconnected us. So one night, I'm about to go, I'm at home and I'm about to go to bed, and Sarah calls me up. She's on the train home from work, but she doesn't usually call me on the way home. But she's kind of like frantic on the phone, quite erratic, and she said, "No, you need to sit down, I've got something to tell you." I said, "Well, I'm lying down, is it?" And she said, "It's about a guy called Mike." And I thought, "You're leaving me." Really dawned on me, you know, the power, the ripple effect these small actions that we all have every single day, yet many of us, we never get to realise the benefit of these small actions. And that evening I got to realise the benefit of that one conversation. And he never took his life and he was happy and I got in touch with Reed Link, sent him an email, said I'm Mike, I'm ill. The rest is kind of history. We're gonna show you a clip of when we met for the second time, 6 years later in January 2014.